1 Kings chapter 17. Elijah was a prophet from Tishbe in Gilead. One day he went to King Ahab and said,
I am a servant of the living God, the God of Israel, and I swear in his name that it won't rain until I say so. There won't even be any dew on the ground.
Later the Lord said to Elijah,
Leave, and go across the Jordan River so you can hide near Kerith Creek. You can drink water from the creek and eat the food I've told the ravens to bring you.
Elijah obeyed the Lord and went to live near Kerith Creek. Ravens brought him bread and meat twice a day, and he drank water from the creek. But after a while it dried up because there was no rain. The Lord told Elijah,
Go to the town of Zarephath in Sidon and live there. I've told a widow in that town to give you food.
When Elijah came near the town gate of Zarephath, he saw a widow gathering sticks for a fire.
Would you please bring me a cup of water?
He asked. As she left to get it, he asked,
Would you also please bring me a piece of bread?
The widow answered,
In the name of the living Lord your God, I swear that I don't have any bread. All I have is a handful of flour and a little olive oil. I'm on my way home now with these few sticks to cook what I have for my son and me. After that, we will starve to death.
Elijah said,
Everything will be fine. Do what you said. Go home and fix something for you and your son. But first, please make a small piece of bread and bring it to me. The Lord God of Israel has promised that your jar of flour won't run out and your bottle of oil won't dry up before he sends rain for the crops.
The widow went home and did exactly what Elijah had told her. She and Elijah and her family had enough food for a long time. The Lord kept the promise that his prophet Elijah had made, and she did not run out of flour or oil. Several days later, the son of the woman who owned the house got sick, and he kept getting worse until finally he died. The woman shouted at Elijah,
What have I done to you? I thought you were God's prophet. Did you come here to cause the death of my son as a reminder that I've sinned against God?
Bring me your son,
Elijah said. Then he took the boy from her arms and carried him upstairs to the room where he was staying. Elijah laid the boy on his bed and prayed.
Lord God, why did you do such a terrible thing to this woman? She's letting me stay here, and now you've let her son die.
Elijah stretched himself out over the boy three times while praying.
Lord God, bring this boy back to life.
The Lord answered Elijah's prayer, and the boy started breathing again. Elijah picked him up and carried him downstairs. He gave the boy to his mother and said,
Look, your son is alive.
You are God's prophet,
the woman replied.
Now I know that you really do speak for the Lord.
1 Kings chapter 18. For 3 years, no rain fell in Samaria, and there was almost nothing to eat anywhere. The Lord said to Elijah,
Go and meet with King Ahab. I will soon make it rain.
So Elijah went to see Ahab. At that time, Obadiah was in charge of Ahab's palace, but he faithfully worshipped the Lord. In fact, when Jezebel was trying to kill the Lord's prophets, Obadiah hid 100 of them in 2 caves and gave them food and water. Ahab sent for Obadiah and said,
We have to find something for our horses and mules to eat. If we don't, we will have to kill them. Let's look around every creek and spring in the country for some grass. You go one way, and I'll go the other.
Then they left in separate directions. As Obadiah was walking along, he met Elijah. Obadiah recognized him, bowed down, and asked,
Elijah! Is it really you?
Yes. Go tell Ahab I'm here.
Obadiah replied,
King Ahab would kill me if I told him that, and I haven't even done anything wrong. I swear to you in the name of the living Lord your God that the king has looked everywhere for you. He sent people to look in every country, And when they couldn't find you, he made the leader of each country swear that you were not in that country. Do you really want me to tell him you're here? What if the Lord's Spirit takes you away as soon as I leave? When Ahab comes to get you, he won't find you. Then he will surely kill me. I have worshipped the Lord since I was a boy. I even hid 100 of the Lord's prophets in caves when Jezebel was trying to kill them. I also gave them food and water. Do you really want me to tell Ahab you're here? He will kill me.
Elijah said,
I'm a servant of the living Lord All-Powerful, and I swear in his name that I will meet with Ahab today.
Obadiah left and told Ahab where to find Elijah. Ahab went to meet Elijah, and when he saw him, Ahab shouted,
There you are, the biggest troublemaker in Israel!
Elijah answered,
You're the troublemaker, not me. You and your family have disobeyed the Lord's commands by worshiping Baal. Call together everyone from Israel and have them meet me on Mount Carmel. Be sure to bring along the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table.
Ahab got everyone together. Then they went to meet Elijah on Mount Carmel. Elijah stood in front of them and said,
How much longer will you try to have things both ways? If the Lord is God, worship him. But if Baal is God, worship him.
The people did not say a word. Then Elijah continued,
I am the Lord's only prophet, but Baal has 450 prophets. Bring us two bulls. Baal's prophets can take one of them, kill it, and cut it into pieces. Then they can put the meat on the wood without lighting the fire. I will do the same thing with the other bull, and I won't light a fire under it either. The prophets of Baal will pray to their God, and I will pray to the Lord. The one who answers by starting the fire is God.
That's a good idea.
Everyone agreed. Elijah said to Baal's prophets,
There are more of you, so you go first. Pick out a bull and get it ready, but don't light the fire. Then pray to your God.
They chose their bull. Then they got it ready and prayed to Baal all morning, asking him to start the fire. They danced around the altar and shouted,
Answer us, Baal!
But there was no answer. At noon, Elijah began making fun of them.
Pray louder,
he said.
Baal must be a god. Maybe he's daydreaming, or using the toilet, or traveling somewhere. Or maybe he's asleep, and you have to wake him up.
The prophets kept shouting louder and louder, and they cut themselves with swords and knives until they were bleeding. This was the way they worshipped, and they kept it up all afternoon. But there was no answer of any kind. Elijah told everyone to gather around him while he repaired the Lord's altar. Then he used 12 stones to build an altar in honor of the Lord. Each stone stood for one of the tribes of Israel, which was the name the Lord had given to their ancestor Jacob. Elijah dug a ditch around the altar, large enough to hold about 13 quarts. He placed the wood on the altar. Then they cut the bull into pieces and laid the meat on the wood. He told the people,
Fill 4 large jars with water and pour it over the meat and the wood.
After they did this, he told them to do it 2 more times. They did exactly as he said until finally the water ran down the altar and filled the ditch. When it was time for the evening sacrifice, Elijah prayed,
Our Lord, you are the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Now prove that you are the God of this nation, and that I, your servant, have done this at your command. Please answer me, so these people will know that you are the Lord God, and that you will turn their hearts back to you.
The Lord immediately sent fire, and it burned up the sacrifice, the wood, and the stones. It scorched the ground everywhere around the altar and dried up every drop of water in the ditch. When the crowd saw what had happened, they all bowed down and shouted,
The Lord is God! The Lord is God!
Just then, Elijah said,
"Grab the prophets of Baal. Don't let any of them get away."
So the people captured the prophets and took them to Kishon River, where Elijah killed every one of them. Elijah told Ahab,
"Get something to eat and drink. I hear a heavy rain coming."
Ahab left, but Elijah climbed back to the top of Mount Carmel. Then he stooped down with his face almost to the ground and said to his servant,
"Look toward the sea."
The servant left, and when he came back, he said,
"I looked, but I didn't see anything."
Elijah told him to look 7 more times. After the 7th time, the servant replied,
"I see a small cloud coming this way, but it's no bigger than a fist."
Elijah told him,
"Tell Ahab to get his chariot ready and start home now. Otherwise, the rain will stop him."
A few minutes later, it got very cloudy and windy, and rain started pouring down. So Elijah wrapped his coat around himself, and the Lord gave him strength to run all the way to Jezreel. Ahab followed him. 1 Kings, chapter 19. Ahab told his wife Jezebel what Elijah had done and that he had killed the prophets. She sent a message to Elijah.
"You killed my prophets! Now I'm going to kill you. I pray that the gods will punish me even more severely if I don't do it by this time tomorrow."
Elijah was afraid when he got her message, and he ran to the town of Beersheba in Judah. He left his servant there, then walked another whole day into the desert. Finally, he came to a large bush and sat down in its shade. He begged the Lord,
"I've had enough. Just let me die. I'm no better off than my ancestors."
Then he lay down in the shade and fell asleep. Suddenly, an angel woke him up and said,
"Get up and eat."
Elijah looked around, and by his head was a jar of water and some baked bread. He sat up, ate and drank, then lay down and went back to sleep. Soon the Lord's angel woke him again and said,
"Get up and eat, or else you'll get too tired to travel."
So Elijah sat up and ate and drank. The food and water made him strong enough to walk 40 more days. At last he reached Mount Sinai, the mountain of God, and he spent the night there in a cave. While Elijah was on Mount Sinai, the Lord asked,
"Elijah, why are you here?"
He answered,
"Lord God All-Powerful, I've always done my best to obey you, but your people have broken their solemn promise to you. They have torn down your altars and killed all your prophets except me. And now they are even trying to kill me."
"Go out and stand on the mountain,"
the Lord replied.
"I want you to see me when I pass by."
All at once, a strong wind shook the mountain and shattered the rocks. But the Lord was not in the wind. Next, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. Then there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. Finally, there was a gentle breeze. And when Elijah heard it, he covered his face with his coat. He went out and stood at the entrance to the cave. The Lord asked,
"Elijah, why are you here?"
Elijah answered,
"Lord God All-Powerful, I've always done my best to obey you, but your people have broken their solemn promise to you. They have torn down your altars and killed all your prophets except me, and now they're even trying to kill me."
The Lord said,
"Elijah, you can go back to the desert near Damascus. And when you get there, appoint Hazael to be king of Syria. Then appoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, to be king of Israel, and Elisha, son of Shaphat, to take your place as my prophet. Hazael will start killing the people who worship Baal. Jehu will kill those who escape from Hazael, and Elisha will kill those who escape from Jehu. But 7,000 Israelites have refused to worship Baal, and they will live."
Elijah left and found Elisha plowing a field with a pair of oxen. There were 11 other men in front of him, and each one was also plowing with a pair of oxen. Elijah went over and put his own coat on Elisha. Elisha stopped plowing and ran after him.
"Let me kiss my parents goodbye, then I'll go with you,"
he said.
You can go,
Elijah said.
But remember what I've done for you.
Elisha left and took his oxen with him. He killed them and boiled them over a fire he had made with the wood from his plow. He gave the meat to the people who were with him, and they ate it. Then he left with Elijah and became his assistant. 1 Kings chapter 20. King Ben-Hadad of Syria called his army together. He was joined by 32 other kings with their horses and chariots, and together they marched to Samaria and attacked. Ben-Hadad sent a messenger to tell King Ahab of Israel,
Ahab, give me your silver and gold, your wives and your strongest sons.
Your Majesty,
Ahab replied,
everything I have is yours, including me.
Later, Ben-Hadad sent another messenger to say to Ahab,
I already told you to give me your silver and gold, your wives and your children. But tomorrow, at this time, I will send my officials into your city to search your palace and the houses of your officials. They will take everything else that you own.
Ahab called a meeting with the leaders of Israel and said,
Ben-Hadad is causing real trouble. He told me to give him my wives and children, as well as my silver and gold. And I agreed.
Don't listen to him,
they answered.
You don't have to do what he says.
So Ahab sent someone to tell Ben-Hadad,
Your Majesty, I'll give you my silver and gold, and even my wives and children, but I won't let you have anything else.
When Ben-Hadad got his answer, he replied,
I'll completely destroy Samaria. There won't even be enough of it left for my soldiers to carry back in their hands. If I don't do it, I pray that the gods will punish me terribly.
Ahab then answered,
Ben-Hadad, don't brag before the fighting even begins. Wait and see if you live through it.
Meanwhile, Ben-Hadad and the other kings had been drinking in their tents. But when Ahab's reply came, he ordered his soldiers to prepare to attack Samaria, and they all got ready. At that very moment, a prophet ran up to Ahab and said,
You can see that Ben-Hadad's army is very strong, but the Lord has promised to help you defeat them today. Then you will know that the Lord is in control.
Who will fight the battle?
Ahab asked. The prophet answered,
The young bodyguards who serve the district officials.
But who will lead them into battle?
Ahab asked.
You will,
the prophet replied. So Ahab called together the 232 young soldiers and the 7,000 troops in Israel's army, and he got them ready to fight the Syrians. At noon, King Ahab and his Israelite army marched out of Samaria with the young soldiers in front. King Ben-Hadad of Syria and the 32 kings with him were drunk when the scouts he had sent out ran up to his tent, shouting,
We just now saw soldiers marching out of Samaria.
Take them alive,
Ben-Hadad ordered.
I don't care if they have come out to fight or to surrender.
The young soldiers led Israel's troops into battle, and each of them attacked and killed an enemy soldier. The rest of the Syrian army turned and ran, and the Israelites went after them. Ben-Hadad and some others escaped on horses, but Ahab and his soldiers followed them and captured their horses and chariots. Ahab and Israel's army crushed the Syrians. Later, the prophet went back and warned Ahab,
Ben-Hadad will attack you again next spring. Build up your troops and make sure you have some good plans.
Meanwhile, Ben-Hadad's officials went to him and explained,
Israel's gods are mountain gods. We fight Israel's army in the hills, and that's why they defeated us. But if we fight them on flat land, there's no way we can lose. Here's what you should do. First, get rid of those 32 kings and put army commanders in their places. Then get more soldiers, horses, and chariots, so your army will be as strong as it was before. We'll fight Israel's army on flat land and wipe them out.
Ben-Hadad agreed and did what they suggested. In the spring, Ben-Hadad got his army together, and they marched to the town of Aphek to attack Israel. The Israelites also prepared to fight. They marched out to meet the Syrians, and the two armies camped across from each other. The Syrians covered the whole area, but the Israelites looked like two little flocks of goats. The prophet went to Ahab and said,
"The Syrians think the Lord is a god of the hills and not of the valleys. So he has promised to help you defeat their powerful army. Then you will know that the Lord is in control."
For 7 days, the two armies stayed in their camps facing each other. Then, on the seventh day, the fighting broke out, and before sunset, the Israelites had killed 100,000 Syrian troops. The rest of the Syrian army ran back to Aphek, but the town wall fell and crushed 27,000 of them. Ben-Hadad also escaped to Aphek and hid in the back room of a house. His officials said,
"Your Majesty, we've heard that Israel's kings keep their agreements. We will wrap sackcloth around our waist, put ropes around our heads, and ask Ahab to let you live."
They dressed in sackcloth and put ropes on their heads. Then they went to Ahab and said,
"Your servant Ben-Hadad asks you to let him live."
"Is he still alive?"
Ahab asked.
"Ben-Hadad is like a brother to me."
Ben-Hadad's officials were trying to figure out what Ahab was thinking. And when he said brother, they quickly replied,
"You're right. You and Ben-Hadad are like brothers."
"Go get him,"
Ahab said. When Ben-Hadad came out, Ahab had him climb up into his chariot. Ben-Hadad said,
"I'll give back the towns my father took from your father. And you can have shops in Damascus, just as my father had in Samaria."
Ahab replied,
"If you do these things, I'll let you go free."
Then they signed a peace treaty, and Ahab let Ben-Hadad go. About this time, the Lord commanded a prophet to say to a friend,
"Hit me!"
But the friend refused, and the prophet told him,
"You disobey the Lord, and as soon as you walk away, a lion will kill you."
The friend left, and suddenly a lion killed him. The prophet found someone else and said,
"Hit me!"
So this man beat him up. The prophet left and put a bandage over his face to disguise himself. Then he went and stood beside the road, waiting for Ahab to pass by. When Ahab went by, the prophet shouted,
"Your Majesty, right in the heat of battle, someone brought a prisoner to me and told me to guard him. He said if the prisoner got away, I would either be killed or forced to pay 75 pounds of silver. But I got busy doing other things, and the prisoner escaped."
Ahab answered,
"You will be punished just as you have said."
The man quickly tore the bandage off his face, and Ahab saw that he was one of the prophets. The prophet said,
"The Lord told you to kill Ben-Hadad, but you let him go. Now you will die in his place, and your people will die in place of his people."
Ahab went back to Samaria, angry and depressed. 1 Kings chapter 21. Naboth owned a vineyard in Jezreel near King Ahab's palace. One day Ahab said,
"Naboth, your vineyard is near my palace. Give it to me so I can turn it into a vegetable garden. I'll give you a better vineyard or pay whatever you want for yours."
Naboth answered,
"This vineyard has always been in my family. I won't let you have it."
So Ahab went home, angry and depressed, because of what Naboth had told him. He lay on his bed, just staring at the wall and refusing to eat a thing. Jezebel, his wife, came in and asked,
"What's wrong? Why won't you eat?"
"I asked Naboth to sell me his vineyard or let me give him a better one,"
Ahab replied.
"And he told me I couldn't have it."
"Aren't you the king of Israel?"
Jezebel asked.
"Get out of bed and eat something. don't worry. I'll get Naboth's vineyard for you.
Jezebel wrote a letter to each of the leaders of the town where Naboth lived. In the letters, she said,
call everyone together and tell them to go without eating today. When they come together, give Naboth a seat at the front. Have two liars sit across from him and swear that Naboth has cursed God and the king. Then take Naboth outside and stone him to death.
She signed Ahab's name to the letters and sealed them with his seal. Then she sent them to the town leaders. After receiving her letters, they did exactly what she had asked. They told the people that it was a day to go without eating, and when they all came together, they seated Naboth at the front. The two liars came in and sat across from Naboth. Then they accused him of cursing God and the king, so the people dragged Naboth outside and stoned him to death. The leaders of Jezreel sent a message back to Jezebel that said,
Naboth is dead.
As soon as Jezebel got their message, she told Ahab,
now you can have the vineyard Naboth refused to sell. He's dead.
Ahab got up and went to take over the vineyard. The Lord said to Elijah the prophet,
King Ahab of Israel is in Naboth's vineyard right now, taking it over. Go tell him that I say, Ahab, you murdered Naboth and took his property. And so, in the very spot where dogs licked up Naboth's blood, they will lick up your blood.
When Elijah found him, Ahab said,
so, my enemy, you found me at last.
Elijah answered,
yes, I did. Ahab, you have managed to do everything the Lord hates. Now you will be punished. You and every man and boy in your family will die. Whether slave or free, your whole family will be wiped out just like the families of King Jeroboam and King Baasha. You've made the Lord very angry by sinning and causing the Israelites to sin. And as for Jezebel, dogs will eat her body there in Jezreel. Dogs will also eat the bodies of your relatives who die in town. And vultures will eat the bodies of those who die in the country.
When Ahab heard this, he tore his clothes and wore sackcloth day and night. He was depressed and refused to eat. Sometime later, the Lord said,
Elijah, do you see how sorry Ahab is for what he did? I won't punish his family while he is still alive. I'll wait until his son is king.
No one was more determined than Ahab to disobey the Lord, and Jezebel encouraged him. Worst of all, he had worshipped idols just as the Amorites had done before the Lord forced them out of the land and gave it to Israel. 1 Kings chapter 22. For the next 3 years there was peace between Israel and Syria. During the third year, King Jehoshaphat of Judah went to visit King Ahab of Israel. Ahab asked his officials,
why haven't we tried to get Ramoth in Gilead back from the Syrians? It belongs to us.
Then he asked Jehoshaphat,
would you go to Ramoth with me and attack the Syrians?
Just tell me what to do.
Jehoshaphat answered,
my army and horses are at your command. But first, let's ask the Lord.
Ahab sent for about 400 prophets and asked,
should I attack the Syrians at Ramoth?
Yes,
the prophets answered.
The Lord will help you defeat them.
But Jehoshaphat said,
just to make sure, is there another of the Lord's prophets we can ask?
We could ask Micaiah son of Imlah,
Ahab said.
But I hate Micaiah. He always has bad news for me.
Don't say that,
Jehoshaphat replied. Then Ahab sent someone to bring Micaiah as soon as possible. All this time, Ahab and Jehoshaphat were dressed in their royal robes and were seated on their thrones at the threshing place near the gate of Samaria. They were listening to the prophets tell them what the Lord had said. Zedekiah, son of Kenaanah, was one of the prophets. He had made some horns out of iron and shouted,
Ahab, the Lord says you will attack the Syrians like a bull with iron horns and wipe them out.
All the prophets agreed that Ahab should attack the Syrians at Ramoth, and they promised that the Lord would help him defeat them. Meanwhile, the messenger who went to get Micaiah whispered,
"Micaiah, all the prophets have good news for Ahab. Now go and say the same thing."
"I'll say whatever the living Lord tells me to say,"
Micaiah replied. Then Micaiah went to Ahab, and Ahab asked,
"Micaiah, should I attack the Syrians at Ramoth?"
"Yes," Micaiah answered. "The Lord will help you defeat them."
"Micaiah, I've told you over and over to tell me the truth,"
Ahab shouted.
"What does the Lord really say?"
He answered,
"In a vision, I saw Israelite soldiers walking around in the hills like sheep without a shepherd to guide them. The Lord said, 'This army has no leader. They should go home and not fight.'"
Ahab turned to Jehoshaphat and said,
"I told you he would bring bad news."
Micaiah replied,
"Listen to this. I also saw the Lord seated on his throne with every creature in heaven gathered around him. The Lord asked, 'Who can trick Ahab and make him go to Ramoth where he will be killed?' They talked about it for a while. Then finally a spirit came forward and said to the Lord, 'I can trick Ahab.' 'How?' the Lord asked. 'I'll make Ahab's prophets lie to him.' 'Good,' the Lord replied. 'Now go and do it.' This is exactly what has happened, Ahab. The Lord made all your prophets lie to you, and he knows you will soon be destroyed."
Zedekiah walked up to Micaiah and slapped him on the face. Then he asked,
"Do you really think the Lord would speak to you and not to me?"
Micaiah answered,
"You'll find out on the day you have to hide in the back room of some house."
Ahab shouted,
"Arrest Micaiah! Take him to Prince Joash and Governor Ammon of Samaria. Tell them to put him in prison and to give him nothing but bread and water until I come back safely."
Micaiah said,
"If you do come back, I was wrong about what the Lord wanted me to say."
Then he told the crowd,
"Don't forget what I said."
Ahab and Jehoshaphat led their armies to Ramoth and Gilead. Before they went into battle, Ahab said,
"Jehoshaphat, I'll disguise myself, but you wear your royal robe."
Then Ahab disguised himself and went into battle. The king of Syria had ordered his 32 chariot commanders to attack only Ahab. So when they saw Jehoshaphat in his robe, they thought he was Ahab and started to attack him. But when Jehoshaphat shouted out to them, they realized he wasn't Ahab, and they left him alone. However, during the fighting, a soldier shot an arrow without even aiming, and it hit Ahab where two pieces of his armor joined. He shouted to his chariot driver,
"I've been hit! Get me out of here!"
The fighting lasted all day, with Ahab propped up in his chariot so he could see the Syrian troops. He bled so much that the bottom of the chariot was covered with blood, and by evening, he was dead. As the sun was going down, someone in Israel's army shouted to the others,
"Retreat! Go back home!"
Ahab's body was taken to Samaria and buried there. Some workers washed his chariot near a spring in Samaria, and prostitutes washed themselves in his blood. Dogs licked Ahab's blood off the ground, just as the Lord had warned. Everything else Ahab did while he was king, including the towns he strengthened and the palace he built and furnished with ivory, is written in the history of the kings of Israel. Ahab died, and his son Ahaziah became king. Jehoshaphat, son of Asa, became king of Judah in Ahab's fourth year as king of Israel. Jehoshaphat was 35 years old when he became king, and he ruled from Jerusalem for 25 years. His mother was Azubah, daughter of Shilhai. Jehoshaphat obeyed the Lord, just as his father Asa had done. And during his rule, he was at peace with the king of Israel. He got rid of the rest of the prostitutes from the local shrines, but he did not destroy the shrines, and they were still used as places for offering sacrifices. Everything else Jehoshaphat did while he was king, including his brave deeds and military victories, is written in the history of the kings of Judah. The country of Edom had no king at the time, so a lower official ruled the land. Jehoshaphat had seagoing ships built to sail to Ophir for gold. But they were wrecked at Ezion-Geber and never sailed. Ahaziah, son of Ahab, offered to let his sailors go with Jehoshaphat's sailors, but Jehoshaphat refused. Jehoshaphat died and was buried beside his ancestors in Jerusalem, and his son Jehoram became king. Ahaziah, son of Ahab, became king of Israel in the 17th year of Jehoshaphat's rule in Judah, and he ruled 2 years from Samaria. Ahaziah disobeyed the Lord, just as his father, his mother, and Jeroboam had done. They all led Israel to sin. Ahaziah worshipped Baal and made the Lord God of Israel very angry, just as his father had done. 2 Kings 2 Kings chapter 1. Soon after King Ahab of Israel died, the country of Moab rebelled against his son, King Ahaziah. One day, Ahaziah fell through the wooden slats around the porch on the flat roof of his palace in Samaria, and he was badly injured. So he sent some messengers to the town of Ekron with orders to ask the god Beelzebub if he would get well. About the same time, an angel from the Lord sent Elijah the prophet from Tishbe to say to the king's messengers,
"Ahaziah has rejected Israel's own God by sending you to ask Beelzebub about his injury. Tell him that because he has done this, he's on his deathbed."
And Elijah did what he was told. When the messengers returned to Ahaziah, he asked,
"Why are you back so soon?"
"A man met us along the road with a message for you from the Lord,"
they answered.
"The Lord wants to know why you sent us to ask Beelzebub about your injury and why you don't believe there's a God in Israel. The man also told us that the Lord says you're going to die."
"What did the man look like?"
Ahaziah asked.
"He was hairy and had a leather belt around his waist,"
they answered.
"It must be Elijah,"
replied Ahaziah. So at once he sent an army officer and 50 soldiers to meet Elijah. Elijah was sitting on top of a hill at the time. The officer went up to him and said,
"Man of God, the king orders you to come down and talk with him."
"If I am a man of God,"
Elijah answered,
"God will send down fire on you and your 50 soldiers."
Fire immediately came down from heaven and burned up the officer and his men. Ahaziah sent another officer and 50 more soldiers to Elijah. The officer said,
"Man of God, the king orders you to come see him right now."
"If I am a man of God,"
Elijah answered,
"fire will destroy you and your 50 soldiers."
And God sent down fire from heaven on the officer and his men. Ahaziah sent a third army officer and 50 more soldiers. This officer went up to Elijah. Then he got down on his knees and begged,
"Man of God, please be kind to me and these 50 servants of yours. Let us live. Fire has already wiped out the other officers and their soldiers. Please don't let it happen to me."
The angel from the Lord said to Elijah,
"Go with him and don't be afraid."
So Elijah got up and went with the officer. When Elijah arrived, he told Ahaziah,
"The Lord wants to know why you sent messengers to Ekron to ask Beelzebub about your injury. Don't you believe there's a God in Israel? Ahaziah, because you did that, the Lord says you will die."
Ahaziah died just as the Lord had said. But since Ahaziah had no sons, Joram, his brother, then became king. This happened in the second year that Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, was king of Judah. Everything else Ahaziah did while he was king is written in the history of the kings of Israel. 2 Kings, chapter 2. Not long before the Lord took Elijah up into heaven in a strong wind, Elijah and Elisha were leaving Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha,
"The Lord wants me to go to Bethel, but you must stay here."
Elisha replied,
"I swear by the living Lord and by your own life that I will stay with you no matter what."
And he went with Elijah to Bethel. A group of prophets who lived there asked Elisha,
"Do you know that today the Lord is going to take away your master?"
"Yes, I do,"
Elisha answered.
"But don't remind me of it."
Elijah then said,
"Elisha, now the Lord wants me to go to Jericho, but you must stay here."
Elisha replied,
"I swear by the living Lord and by your own life that I will stay with you no matter what."
And he went with Elijah to Jericho. A group of prophets who lived there asked Elisha,
"Do you know that today the Lord is going to take away your master?"
"Yes, I do,"
Elisha answered.
"But don't remind me of it."
Elijah then said to Elisha,
"Now the Lord wants me to go to the Jordan River, but you must stay here."
Elisha replied,
"I swear by the living Lord and by your own life that I will never leave you."
So the two of them walked on together. 50 prophets followed Elijah and Elisha from Jericho, then stood at a distance and watched as the two men walked toward the river. When they got there, Elijah took off his coat, then he rolled it up and struck the water with it. At once a path opened up through the river, and the two of them walked across on dry ground. After they had reached the other side, Elijah said,
"Elisha, the Lord will soon take me away. What can I do for you before that happens?"
Elisha answered,
"Please, give me twice as much of your power as you give the other prophets, so I can be the one who takes your place as their leader."
"It won't be easy,"
Elijah answered.
"It can happen only if you see me as I'm being taken away."
Elijah and Elisha were walking along and talking when suddenly there appeared between them a flaming chariot pulled by fiery horses. Right away, a strong wind took Elijah up into heaven. Elisha saw this and shouted,
"Israel's cavalry and chariots have taken my master away."
After Elijah had gone, Elisha tore his clothes in sorrow. Elijah's coat had fallen off, so Elisha picked it up and walked back to the Jordan River. He struck the water with the coat and wondered,
"Will the Lord perform miracles for me as he did for Elijah?"
As soon as Elisha did this, a dry path opened up through the water and he walked across. When the prophets from Jericho saw what happened, they said to each other,
"Elisha now has Elijah's power."
They walked over to him, bowed down, and said,
"There are 50 strong men here with us. Please let them go look for your master. Maybe the Spirit of the Lord carried him off to some mountain or valley."
"No,"
Elisha replied.
"They won't find him."
They kept begging until he was embarrassed to say no. He finally agreed, and the prophet sent the men out. They looked 3 days for Elijah, but never found him. They returned to Jericho, and Elisha said,
"I told you that you wouldn't find him."
One day, the people of Jericho said,
"Elisha, you can see that our city is in a good spot, but the water from our spring is so bad that it even keeps our crops from growing."
He replied,
"Put some salt in a new bowl and bring it to me."
They brought him the bowl of salt, and he carried it to the spring. He threw the salt into the water and said,
"The Lord has made this water pure again. From now on, you'll be able to grow crops, and no one will starve."
The water has been fine ever since, just as Elisha said. Elisha left and headed toward Bethel. Along the way, some boys started making fun of him by shouting,
"Go away, Baldy! Get out of here!"
Elisha turned around and stared at the boys. Then he cursed them in the name of the Lord. Right away, two bears ran out of the woods and ripped to pieces 42 of the boys. Elisha went up to Mount Carmel, then returned to Samaria. 2 Kings, chapter 3. Joram, son of Ahab, became king of Israel in Jehoshaphat's 18th year as king of Judah. Joram ruled 12 years from Samaria and disobeyed the Lord by doing wrong. He tore down the stone image his father had made to honor Baal, and so he wasn't as sinful as his parents. But he kept doing the sinful things that Jeroboam, son of Nebat, had led Israel to do. For many years, the country of Moab had been controlled by Israel and was forced to pay taxes to the kings of Israel. King Misha of Moab raised sheep, so he paid the king of Israel 100,000 lambs and the wool from 100,000 rams. But soon after the death of Ahab, Misha rebelled against Israel. One day, Joram left Samaria and called together Israel's army. He sent this message to King Jehoshaphat of Judah.
The king of Moab has rebelled. Will you go with me to attack him?
Yes, I will,
Jehoshaphat answered.
I am on your side, and my soldiers and horses are at your command. But which way should we go?
We will march through Edom Desert,
Joram replied. So Joram, Jehoshaphat, and the king of Edom led their troops out. But 7 days later, there was no drinking water left for them or their animals. Joram cried out,
This is terrible. The Lord must have led us out here to be captured by Moab's army.
Jehoshaphat said,
Which of the Lord's prophets is with us? We can find out from him what the Lord wants us to do.
One of Joram's officers answered,
Elisha, son of Shaphat, is here. He was one of Elijah's closest followers.
Jehoshaphat replied,
He can give us the Lord's message.
The three kings went over to Elisha, and he asked Joram,
Why did you come to me? Go talk to the prophets of the foreign gods your parents worshipped.
No,
Joram answered.
It was the Lord who led us out here so that Moab's army could capture us.
Elisha said to him,
I serve the Lord all-powerful, and as surely as he lives, I swear I wouldn't even look at you if I didn't respect King Jehoshaphat.
Then Elisha said,
Send for someone who can play the harp.
The harpist began playing, and the Lord gave Elisha this message for Joram.
The Lord says that this dry riverbed will be filled with water. You won't feel any wind or see any rain, but there will be plenty of water for you and your animals. That simple thing isn't all the Lord is going to do. He will also help you defeat Moab's army. You will capture all their walled cities and important towns. You will chop down every good tree and stop up every spring of water, then ruin their fertile fields by covering them with rocks.
The next morning, while the sacrifice was being offered, water suddenly started flowing from the direction of Edom, and it flooded the land. Meanwhile, the people of Moab had heard that the three kings were coming to attack them. They had called together all of their fighting men, from the youngest to the oldest, and these troops were now standing at their border ready for battle. When they got up that morning, the sun was shining across the water, making it look red. The Moabite troops took one look and shouted,
Look at that blood! The armies of those kings must have fought and killed each other. Come on, let's go take what's left in their camp.
But when they arrived at Israel's camp, the Israelite soldiers came out and attacked them until they turned and ran away. Israel's army chased them all the way back to Moab, and even there they kept up the attack. The Israelites destroyed the Moabite towns. They chopped down the good trees and stopped up the springs of water, then covered the fertile fields with rocks. Finally, the only city left standing was Kir Hareseth. But soldiers armed with slings surrounded and attacked it. King Misha of Moab saw that he was about to be defeated. So he took along 700 soldiers with swords and tried to break through the front line where the Edomite troops were positioned. But he failed. He then grabbed his oldest son, who was to be the next king, and sacrificed him as an offering on the city wall. The Israelite troops were so horrified that they left the city and went back home. 2 Kings chapter 4. One day the widow of one of the Lord's prophets said to Elisha,
You know that before my husband died, he was a follower of yours and a worshipper of the Lord. But he owed a man some money, and now that man is on his way to take my two sons as his slaves.
Maybe there's something I can do to help,
Elisha said.
What do you have in your house?
Sir, I have nothing but a small bottle of olive oil.
Elisha told her,
Ask your neighbors for their empty jars, and after you've borrowed as many as you can, go home and shut the door behind you and your sons. Then begin filling the jars with oil, and set each one aside as you fill it.
The woman left. Later, when she and her sons were back inside their house, the two sons brought her the jars, and she began filling them. At last, she said to one of her sons,
Bring me another jar.
We don't have any more.
He answered, and the oil stopped flowing from the small bottle. After she told Elisha what had happened, he said,
Sell the oil and use part of the money to pay what you owe the man. You and your sons can live on what is left.
Once, while Elisha was in the town of Shunem, he met a rich woman who invited him to her home for dinner. After that, whenever he was in Shunem, he would have a meal there with her and her husband. Sometime later, the woman said to her husband,
I'm sure the man who comes here so often is a prophet of God. Why don't we build him a small room on the flat roof of our house? We can put a bed, a table and chair, and an oil lamp in it. Then, whenever he comes, he can stay with us.
The next time Elisha was in Shunem, he stopped at their house and went up to his room to rest. He said to his servant Gehazi,
This woman has been very helpful. Have her come up here to the roof for a moment.
She came, and Elisha told Gehazi to say to her, You've gone to a lot of trouble for us, and we want to help you. Is there something we can request the king or army commander to do? The woman answered,
With my relatives nearby, I have everything I need.
Then what can we do for her?
Elisha asked Gehazi. Gehazi replied, I do know that her husband is old and that she doesn't have a son. Ask her to come here again, Elisha told his servant. He called for her, and she came and stood in the doorway of Elisha's room. Elisha said to her,
Next year at this time, you'll be holding your own baby son in your arms.
You're a man of God,
the woman replied.
Please, don't lie to me.
But a few months later, the woman got pregnant. She gave birth to a son just as Elisha had promised. One day, while the boy was still young, he was out in the fields with his father, where the workers were harvesting the crops. Suddenly he shouted,
My head hurts! It hurts a lot!
Carry him back to his mother,
the father said to his servant. The servant picked up the boy and carried him to his mother. The boy lay on her lap all morning, and by noon he was dead. She carried him upstairs to Elisha's room and laid him across the bed. Then she walked out and shut the door behind her. The woman called to her husband.
I need to see the prophet. Let me use one of the donkeys. Send a servant along with me and let me leave now so I can get back quickly.
Why do you need to see him today?
Her husband asked.
It's not the Sabbath or time for the new moon festival.
That's all right,
she answered. She saddled the donkey and said to her servant,
Let's go, and don't slow down unless I tell you to.
She left at once for Mount Carmel to talk with Elisha. When Elisha saw her coming, he said,
Gehazi, look, it's the woman from Shunem. Run and meet her, and ask her if everything is all right with her and her family.
Everything is fine,
she answered Gehazi. But as soon as she got to the top of the mountain, she went over and grabbed Elisha by the feet. Gehazi started toward her to push her away when Elisha said,
Leave her alone. Don't you see how sad she is? But the Lord hasn't told me why.
The woman said,
Sir, I begged you not to get my hopes up, and I didn't even ask you for a son.
Gehazi, get ready and go to her house,
Elisha said.
Take along my walking stick, and when you get there, lay it on the boy's face. Don't stop to talk to anyone, even if they try to talk to you.
But the boy's mother said to Elisha,
I swear by the living Lord and by your own life that I won't leave without you.
So Elisha got up and went with them. Gehazi ran on ahead and laid Elisha's walking stick on the boy's face, but the boy didn't move or make a sound. Gehazi ran back to Elisha and said,
The boy didn't wake up.
Elisha arrived at the woman's house and went straight to his room, where he saw the boy's body on his bed. He walked in, shut the door, and prayed to the Lord. Then he got on the bed and stretched out over the dead body, with his mouth on the boy's mouth, his eyes on his eyes, and his hand on his hands. As he lay there, the boy's body became warm. Elisha got up and walked back and forth in the room. Then he went back and leaned over the boy's body. The boy sneezed 7 times and opened his eyes. Elisha called out to Gehazi,
"Have the boy's mother come here."
Gehazi did, and when she was at the door, Elisha said,
"You can take your son."
She came in and bowed down at Elisha's feet. Then she picked up her son and left. Later, Elisha went back to Gilgal, where there was almost nothing to eat because the crops had failed. One day, while the prophets who lived there were meeting with Elisha, he said to his servant,
"Fix a big pot of stew for these prophets."
One of them went out into the woods to gather some herbs. He found a wild vine and picked as much of its fruit as he could carry, but he didn't know that the fruit was very sour. When he got back, he cut up the fruit and put it in the stew. The stew was served, and when the prophets started eating it, they shouted,
"Elisha, this stew tastes terrible. We can't eat it."
"Bring me some flour,"
Elisha said. He sprinkled the flour in the stew and said, "Now serve it to them." And the stew tasted fine. A man from the town of Baal Shalisha brought Elisha some freshly cut grain and 20 loaves of bread made from the first barley that was harvested. Elisha said,
"Give it to the people so they can eat."
"There's not enough here for 100 people,
his servant said.
"Just give it to them,"
Elisha replied.
"The Lord has promised there will be more than enough."
So the servant served the bread and grain to the people. They ate and still had some left over, just as the Lord had promised. 2 Kings chapter 5. Naaman was the commander of the Syrian army. The Lord had helped him and his troops defeat their enemies, so the king of Syria respected Naaman very much. Naaman was a brave soldier, but he had leprosy. One day, while the Syrian troops were raiding Israel, they captured a girl, and she became a servant of Naaman's wife. Sometime later, the girl said,
"If your husband Naaman would go to the prophet in Samaria, he would be cured of his leprosy."
When Naaman told the king what the girl had said, the king replied,
"Go ahead. I will give you a letter to take to the king of Israel."
Naaman left and took along 750 pounds of silver, 150 pounds of gold, and 10 new outfits. He also carried the letter to the king of Israel. It said,
"I am sending my servant Naaman to you. Would you cure him of his leprosy?"
When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes in fear and shouted,
"That Syrian king believes I can cure this man of leprosy. Does he think I'm God with power over life and death? He must be trying to pick a fight with me."
As soon as Elisha the prophet heard what had happened, he sent the Israelite king this message.
"Why are you so afraid? Send the man to me so that he will know there is a prophet in Israel."
Naaman left with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent someone outside to say to him,
"Go wash 7 times in the Jordan River. Then you will be completely cured."
But Naaman stormed off, grumbling,
"Why couldn't he come out and talk to me? I thought for sure he would stand in front of me and pray to the Lord his God, then wave his hand over my skin and cure me. What about the Abana River or the Pharpar River? Those rivers in Damascus are just as good as any river in Israel. I could have washed in them and been cured."
His servants went over to him and said,
"Sir, if the prophet had told you to do something difficult, you would have done it. So why don't you do what he said? Go wash and be cured."
Naaman walked down to the Jordan. He waded out into the water and stooped down in it 7 times, just as Elisha had told him. Right away he was cured, and his skin became as smooth as a child's. Naaman and his officials went back to Elisha. Naaman stood in front of him and announced,
"Now I know that the God of Israel is the only God in the whole world." Sir, would you please accept a gift from me?
I am a servant of the living Lord,
Elisha answered,
and I swear that I will not take anything from you.
Naaman kept begging, but Elisha kept refusing. Finally, Naaman said,
If you won't accept a gift, then please let me take home as much soil as two mules can pull in a wagon. Sir, from now on I will offer sacrifices only to the Lord. But I pray that the Lord will forgive me when I go into the temple of the god Rimmon and bow down there with the king of Syria.
Go on home, and don't worry about that,
Elisha replied. Then Naaman left. After Naaman had gone only a short distance, Gehazi said to himself,
Elisha let that Syrian off too easy. He should have taken Naaman's gift. I swear by the living Lord that I will talk to Naaman myself and get something from him.
So he hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw Gehazi running after him, he got out of his chariot to meet him. Naaman asked,
Is everything all right?
Yes,
Gehazi answered.
But my master has sent me to tell you about two young prophets from the hills of Ephraim. They came asking for help, and now Elisha wants to know if you would give them about 75 pounds of silver and some new clothes.
Sure,
Naaman replied.
But why don't you take twice that amount of silver?
He convinced Gehazi to take it all, then put the silver in two bags. He handed the bags and the clothes to his two servants, and they carried them for Gehazi. When they reached the hill where Gehazi lived, he took the bags from the servants and placed them in his house, then sent the men away. After they had gone, Gehazi went in and stood in front of Elisha, who asked,
Gehazi, where have you been?
Nowhere, sir,
Gehazi answered. Elisha asked,
Don't you know that my spirit was there when Naaman got out of his chariot to talk with you? Gehazi, you have no right to accept money or clothes, olive orchards or vineyards, sheep or cattle or servants. Because of what you've done, Naaman's leprosy will now be on you and your descendants forever.
Suddenly, Gehazi's skin became white with leprosy, and he left. 2 Kings, chapter 6. One day the prophets said to Elisha,
The place where we meet with you is too small. Why don't we build a new meeting place near the Jordan River? Each of us could get some wood, then we could build it.
That's a good idea,
Elisha replied.
Get started.
Aren't you going with us?
One of the prophets asked.
Yes, I'll go,
Elisha answered, and he left with them. They went to the Jordan River and began chopping down trees. While one of the prophets was working, his axe head fell off and dropped into the water.
Oh!
He shouted.
Sir, I borrowed this axe.
Where did it fall in?
Elisha asked. The prophet pointed to the place, and Elisha cut a stick and threw it into the water at that spot. The axe head floated to the top of the water.
Now get it,
Elisha told him. And the prophet reached in and grabbed it. Time after time, when the king of Syria was at war against the Israelites, he met with his officers and announced,
I've decided where we will set up camp.
Each time, Elisha would send this warning to the king of Israel.
Don't go near there. That's where the Syrian troops have set up camp.
So the king would warn the Israelite troops in that place to be on guard. The king of Syria was furious when he found out what was happening. He called in his officers and asked,
Which one of you has been telling the king of Israel our plans?
None of us, your majesty,
one of them answered.
It's an Israelite named Elisha. He's a prophet, so he can tell his king everything, even what you say in your own room.
Find out where he is,
the king ordered.
I'll send soldiers to bring him here.
They learned that Elisha was in the town of Dothan and reported it to the king. He ordered his best troops to go there with horses and chariots. They marched out during the night and surrounded the town. When Elisha's servant got up the next morning, he saw that Syrian troops had the town surrounded.
Sir,
What are we going to do?
He asked.
Don't be afraid.
Elisha answered.
There are more troops on our side than on theirs.
Then he prayed.
Lord, please help him to see.
And the Lord let the servant see that the hill was covered with fiery horses and flaming chariots all around Elisha. As the Syrian army came closer, Elisha prayed,
Lord, make these soldiers blind.
And the Lord blinded them with a bright light. Elisha told the enemy troops,
You've taken the wrong road and are in the wrong town. Follow me. I'll lead you to the man you're looking for.
Elisha led them straight to the capital city of Samaria. When all the soldiers were inside the city, Elisha prayed,
Lord, now let them see again.
The Lord let them see that they were standing in the middle of Samaria. The king of Israel saw them and asked Elisha,
Should I kill them, sir?
No,
Elisha answered.
You didn't capture these troops in battle, so you have no right to kill them. Instead, give them something to eat and drink, and let them return to their leader.
The king ordered a huge meal to be prepared for Syria's army, and when they finished eating, he let them go. For a while, the Syrian troops stopped invading Israel's territory. Sometime later, King Ben-Hadad of Syria called his entire army together. Then they marched to Samaria and attacked. They kept up the attack until there was nothing to eat in the city. In fact, a donkey's head cost about 2 pounds of silver, and a small bowl of pigeon droppings cost about 2 ounces of silver. One day, as the king of Israel was walking along the top of the city wall, a woman shouted to him,
Please, Your Majesty, help me.
Let the Lord help you,
the king said.
Do you think I have grain or wine to give you?
Then he asked,
What's the matter anyway?
The woman answered,
Another woman and I were so hungry that we agreed to eat our sons. She said if we ate my son one day, we could eat hers the next day. So yesterday we cooked my son and ate him. But today, when I went to her house to eat her son, she had hidden him.
The king tore off his clothes in sorrow, and since he was on top of the city wall, the people saw that he was wearing sackcloth underneath. He said,
I pray that God will punish me terribly if Elisha's head is still on his shoulders by this time tomorrow.
Then he sent a messenger to Elisha. Elisha was home at the time, and the important leaders of Israel were meeting with him. Even before the king's messenger arrived, Elisha told the leaders,
That murderer is sending someone to cut off my head. When you see him coming, shut the door and don't let him in. I'm sure the king himself will be right behind him.
Before Elisha finished talking, the messenger came up and said,
The Lord has made all these terrible things happen to us. Why should I think he will help us now?
2 Kings, chapter 7. Elisha answered,
I have a message for you. The Lord promises that tomorrow here in Samaria, you will be able to buy a large sack of flour or 2 large sacks of barley for almost nothing.
The chief officer there with the king replied,
I don't believe it. Even if the Lord sent a rainstorm, it couldn't produce that much grain by tomorrow.
You will see it happen, but you won't eat any of the food.
Elisha warned him. About the same time, 4 men with leprosy were just outside the gate of Samaria. They said to each other,
Why should we sit here waiting to die? There's nothing to eat in this city, so we would starve if we went inside.
But if we stay out here, we will die for sure. Let's sneak over to the Syrian army camp and surrender. They might kill us, but they might not.
That evening, the 4 men got up and left for the Syrian camp. As they walked toward the camp, the Lord caused the Syrian troops to hear what sounded like the roar of a huge cavalry. The soldiers said to each other,
Listen, the king of Israel must have hired Hittite and Egyptian troops to attack us. Let's get out of here.
So they ran out of their camp that night, leaving their tents and horses and donkeys. When the four men with leprosy reached the edge of the Syrian camp, no one was there. They walked into one of the tents, where they ate and drank, before carrying off clothes as well as silver and gold. They hid all this, then walked into another tent. They took what they wanted and hid it too. They said to each other,
"This isn't right. Today is a day to celebrate, and we haven't told anyone else what has happened. If we wait until morning, we'll be punished. Let's go to the king's palace right now and tell the good news."
They went back to Samaria and shouted up to the guards at the gate,
"We've just come from the Syrian army camp, and all the soldiers are gone. The tents are empty, and the horses and donkeys are still tied up. We didn't see or hear anybody."
The guards reported the news to the king's palace. The king got out of bed and said to his officers,
"I know what those Syrians are doing. They know we're starving, so they're hiding in the fields, hoping we will go out to look for food. When we do, they can capture us and take over our city."
One of his officers replied,
"We have a few horses left. Why don't we let some men take 5 of them and go down to the Syrian camp and see what's happening? We're going to die anyway, like those who have already died."
They found 2 chariots, and the king commanded the men to find out what had happened to the Syrian troops. The men rode as far as the Jordan River. All along the way, they saw clothes and equipment that the Syrians had thrown away as they escaped. Then they went back to the king and told him what they had seen. At once, the people went to the Syrian camp and carried off what was left. They took so much that a large sack of flour and 2 large sacks of barley sold for almost nothing, just as the Lord had promised. The king of Israel had put his chief officer in charge of the gate, but he died when the people trampled him as they rushed out of the city. Earlier, when the king was at Elisha's house, Elisha had told him that flour or barley would sell for almost nothing. But the officer refused to believe that even the Lord could do that. So Elisha warned him that he would see it happen, but would not eat any of the food. And that's exactly what happened. The officer was trampled to death. 2 Kings chapter 8. Elisha told the woman whose son he had brought back to life,
"The Lord has warned that there will be no food here for 7 years. Take your family and go live somewhere else for a while."
The woman did exactly what Elisha had said and went to live in Philistine territory. She and her family lived there 7 years. Then she returned to Israel and immediately begged the king to give back her house and property. Meanwhile, the king was asking Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, about the amazing things Elisha had been doing. While Gehazi was telling him that Elisha had brought a dead boy back to life, the woman and her son arrived.
"Here's the boy, Your Majesty," Gehazi said.
"And this is his mother."
The king asked the woman to tell her story, and she told him everything that had happened. He then said to one of his officials,
"I want you to make sure that this woman gets back everything that belonged to her, including the money her crops have made since the day she left Israel."
Sometime later, Elisha went to the capital city of Damascus to visit King Ben-Hadad of Syria, who was sick. And when Ben-Hadad was told he was there, he said to Hazael,
"Go meet with Elisha, the man of God, and have him ask the Lord if I will get well, and take along a gift for him."
Hazael left with 40 camel loads of the best things made in Damascus as a gift for Elisha. He found the prophet and said,
"Your servant, King Ben-Hadad, wants to know if he will get well."
"Tell him he will,"
Elisha said to Hazael.
"But the Lord has already told me that Ben-Hadad will definitely die."
Elisha stared at him until Hazael was embarrassed. Then Elisha began crying.
"Sir, why are you crying?"
Hazael asked. Elisha answered,
"Because I know the terrible things you will do to the people of Israel. You will burn down their walled cities and slaughter their young men. You will even crush the heads of their babies and rip open their pregnant women."
"How could I ever do anything like that?"
Hazael replied.
"I'm only a servant and don't have that kind of power."
"Hazael, the Lord has told me that you will be the next king of Syria."
Hazael went back to Ben-Hadad and told him,
Elisha said that you will get well.
But the very next day, Haziel got a thick blanket. He soaked it in water and held it over Ben-Hadad's face until he died. Haziel then became king. Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, became king of Judah in Joram's fifth year as king of Israel, while Jehoshaphat was still king of Judah. Jehoram was 32 years old when he became king, and he ruled 8 years from Jerusalem. Jehoram disobeyed the Lord by doing wrong. He married Ahab's daughter and was as sinful as Ahab's family and the kings of Israel. But the Lord refused to destroy Judah because he had promised his servant David that someone from his family would always rule in Judah. While Jehoram was king, the people of Edom rebelled and chose their own king. So Jehoram and his cavalry marched to Zair, where the Edomite army surrounded him and his commanders. During the night, he attacked the Edomites, but he was defeated, and his troops escaped to their homes. Judah was never able to regain control of Edom. Even the town of Libna rebelled at that time. Everything else Jehoram did while he was king is written in the history of the kings of Judah. Jehoram died and was buried beside his ancestors in Jerusalem. His son Ahaziah then became king. Ahaziah, son of Jehoram, became king of Judah in the 12th year of Joram's rule in Israel. Ahaziah was 22 years old when he became king, and he ruled from Jerusalem for only 1 year. His mother was Athaliah, a granddaughter of King Omri of Israel. Since Ahaziah was related to Ahab's family, he acted just like them and disobeyed the Lord by doing wrong. Ahaziah went with King Joram of Israel to attack King Hazael and the Syrian troops at Ramoth in Gilead. Joram was wounded in that battle, so he went to the town of Jezreel to recover. Ahaziah went there to visit him. 2 Kings chapter 9. One day, Elisha called for one of the other prophets and said,
"Take this bottle of olive oil and get ready to go to the town of Ramoth in Gilead. When you get there, find Jehu, son of Jehoshaphat and grandson of Nimshi. Take him to a place where the two of you can be alone. Then pour olive oil on his head to show that he is the new king. Say to him, 'The Lord has chosen you to be king of Israel.' Then leave quickly. Don't wait around for anything."
The young prophet left for Ramoth. When he arrived, the army officers were meeting together.
"Sir, I have a message for you," he said.
"For which one of us?"
Jehu asked.
"You, sir,"
the prophet answered. So Jehu got up and went inside. The prophet poured olive oil on Jehu's head and told him,
"The Lord God of Israel has this message for you. I am the Lord, and I have chosen you to be king of my people Israel. I want you to wipe out the family of Ahab, so Jezebel will be punished for killing the prophets and my other servants. Every man and boy in Ahab's family must die, whether slave or free. His whole family must be destroyed, just like the families of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, and Baasha, son of Ahijah. As for Jezebel, her body will be eaten by dogs in the town of Jezreel. There won't be enough left of her to bury."
Then the young prophet opened the door and ran out. Jehu went back to his officers, and one of them asked,
"What did that crazy prophet want? Is everything all right?"
"You know him and how he talks,"
Jehu answered.
"No, we don't. What did he say?"
they asked.
"He had a message from the Lord,"
Jehu replied.
"He said that the Lord has chosen me to be the next king of Israel."
They quickly grabbed their coats and spread them out on the steps where Jehu was standing. Someone blew a trumpet and everyone shouted,
"Jehu is king!"
King Joram of Israel had been badly wounded in the battle at Ramoth, trying to defend it against King Hazael and the Syrian army. Joram was now recovering in Jezreel, and King Ahaziah of Judah was there visiting him. Meanwhile, Jehu was in Ramoth, making plans to kill Joram. He said to his officers,
"If you want me to be king, then don't let anyone leave this town. They might go to Jezreel and tell Joram."
Then Jehu got in his chariot and rode to Jezreel. When the guard in the watchtower at Jezreel saw Jehu and his men riding up, he shouted to the king,
"I see a bunch of men coming this way."
Joram ordered,
"Send someone out to ask them if this is a friendly visit."
One of the soldiers rode out and said to Jehu,
"King Joram wants to know if this is a friendly visit."
"What's it to you?"
Jehu asked.
"Just stay behind me with the rest of my troops."
About the same time, the guard in the watchtower said,
"Your Majesty, the rider got there, but he isn't coming back."
So Joram sent out another rider who rode up to Jehu and said,
"The king wants to know if this is a friendly visit."
"What's it to you?"
Jehu asked.
"Just get behind me with the rest of my troops."
The guard in the watchtower said,
"Your Majesty, the rider got there, but he isn't coming back either. Wait a minute. That one man is a reckless chariot driver. It must be Jehu."
Joram commanded,
"Get my chariot ready."
Then he and Ahaziah got in their chariots and rode out to meet Jehu. They all met on the land that had belonged to Naboth. Joram asked,
"Jehu, is this a peaceful visit?"
"How can there be peace?"
Jehu asked.
"Your mother, Jezebel, has caused everyone to worship idols and practice witchcraft."
"Ahaziah, let's get out of here!"
Joram yelled.
"It's a trap!"
As Joram tried to escape, Jehu shot an arrow. It hit Joram between his shoulders. Then it went through his heart and came out his chest. He fell over dead in his chariot. Jehu commanded his assistant Bidkar,
"Get Joram's body and throw it in the field that Naboth once owned. Do you remember when you and I used to ride side by side behind Joram's father Ahab? It was then that the Lord swore to Ahab that he would be punished in the same field where he had killed Naboth and his sons. So throw Joram's body there, just as the Lord said."
Ahaziah saw all of this happen and tried to escape to the town of Beth-Hagan, but Jehu caught up with him and shouted,
"Kill him too!"
So his troops shot Ahaziah with an arrow while he was on the road to Gur near Ibleam. He went as far as Megiddo, where he died. Ahaziah's officers put his body in a chariot and took it back to Jerusalem, where they buried him beside his ancestors. Ahaziah had become king of Judah in the 11th year of the rule of Ahab's son Joram. Jehu headed toward Jezreel, and when Jezebel heard he was coming, she put on eyeshadow and brushed her hair. Then she stood at the window, waiting for him to arrive. As he walked through the city gate, she shouted down to him,
"Why did you come here, you murderer, to kill the king? You're no better than Zimri."
He looked up toward the window and asked,
"Is anyone up there on my side?"
A few palace workers stuck their heads out of a window, and Jehu shouted,
"Throw her out the window."
They threw her down, and her blood spattered on the walls and on the horses that trampled her body. Jehu left to get something to eat and drink. Then he told some workers,
"Even though she was evil, she was a king's daughter. So make sure she has a proper burial."
But when they went out to bury her body, they found only her skull, her hands, and her feet. They reported this to Jehu, and he said,
"The Lord told Elijah the prophet that Jezebel's body would be eaten by dogs right here in Jezreel. And he warned that her bones would be spread all over the ground like manure, so that no one could tell who it was."
2 Kings, chapter 10. Ahab still had 70 descendants living in Samaria. So Jehu wrote a letter to each of the important leaders and officials of the town, and to those who supported Ahab. In the letters he wrote,
"Your town is strong, and you are protected by chariots and an armed cavalry. And I know that King Ahab's descendants live there with you. So as soon as you read this letter, choose the best person for the job and make him the next king. Then be prepared to defend Ahab's family."
The officials and leaders read the letters and were very frightened. They said to each other,
Jehu has already killed King Joram and King Ahaziah. We have to do what he says.
The prime minister, the mayor of the city, as well as the other leaders and Ahab's supporters, sent this answer to Jehu.
We are your servants, your majesty, and we will do whatever you tell us. But it's not our place to choose someone to be king. You do what you think is best.
Jehu then wrote another letter which said,
If you are on my side and will obey me, then prove it. Bring me the heads of the descendants of Ahab and be here in Jezreel by this time tomorrow.
The 70 descendants of King Ahab were living with some of the most important people of the city. And when these people read Jehu's second letter, they called together all 70 of Ahab's descendants. They killed them, put their heads in baskets, and sent them to Jezreel. When Jehu was told what had happened, he said,
Put the heads in two piles at the city gate, and leave them there until morning.
The next morning, Jehu went out and stood where everyone could hear him, and he said,
You people are not guilty of anything. I'm the one who plotted against Joram and had him killed. But who killed all these men? Listen to me. Everything the Lord's servant Elijah promised about Ahab's family will come true.
Then Jehu killed the rest of Ahab's relatives living in Jezreel, as well as his highest officials, his priests, and his closest friends. No one in Ahab's family was left alive in Jezreel. Jehu left for Samaria, and along the way he met some relatives of King Ahaziah of Judah at a place where shepherds meet. He asked,
Who are you?
We are relatives of Ahaziah,
they answered.
We are going to visit his family.
Take them alive,
Jehu said to his officers. So they grabbed them and led them to the well near the shepherd's meeting place, where they killed all 42 of them. As Jehu went on, he saw Jehonadab, son of Rechab, coming to meet him. Jehu greeted him, then said,
Jehonadab, I'm on your side. Are you on mine?
Yes, I am.
Then give me your hand,
Jehu answered. He helped Jehonadab into his chariot and said,
Come with me and see how faithful I am to the Lord.
They rode together in Jehu's chariot to Samaria. Jehu killed everyone there who belonged to Ahab's family, as well as all his officials. Everyone in his family was now dead, just as the Lord had promised Elijah. Jehu called together the people in Samaria and said,
King Ahab sometimes worshiped Baal, but I will be completely faithful to Baal. I'm going to offer a huge sacrifice to him. So invite his prophets and priests, and be sure everyone who worships him is there. Anyone who doesn't come will be killed.
But this was a trick. Jehu was really planning to kill the worshipers of Baal. He said,
Announce a day of worship for Baal.
After the day had been announced, Jehu sent an invitation to everyone in Israel. All the worshipers of Baal came, and the temple was filled from one end to the other. Jehu told the official in charge of the sacred robes to make sure that everyone had a robe to wear. Jehu and Jehonadab went into the temple, and Jehu said to the crowd,
Look around and make sure that only the worshipers of Baal are here. No one who worships the Lord is allowed in.
Then they began to offer sacrifices to Baal. Earlier, Jehu had ordered 80 soldiers to wait outside the temple. He had warned them,
I will get all these worshipers here, and if any of you let even one of them escape, you will be killed instead.
As soon as Jehu finished offering the sacrifice, he told the guards and soldiers,
Come in and kill them. Don't let anyone escape.
They slaughtered everyone in the crowd and threw the bodies outside. Then they went back into the temple and carried out the image of Baal. They burned it and broke it into pieces. Then they completely destroyed Baal's temple. And since that time, it's been nothing but a public toilet. That's how Jehu stopped the worship of Baal in Israel. But he did not stop the worship of the gold statues of calves at Dan and Bethel that Jeroboam had made for the people to worship. Later, the Lord said,
Jehu, you have done right by destroying Ahab's entire family, just as I had planned. So I will make sure that the next four kings of Israel will come from your own family.
But Jehu did not completely obey the commands of the Lord God of Israel. Instead, he kept doing the sinful things that Jeroboam had caused the Israelites to do. In those days, the Lord began to reduce the size of Israel's territory. King Hazael of Syria defeated the Israelites and took control of the regions of Gilead and Bashan, east of the Jordan River, and north of the town of Aroer, near the Arnon River. This was the land where the tribes of Gad, Reuben, and Manasseh had once lived. Everything else Jehu did while he was king, including his brave deeds, is written in the history of the kings of Israel. Jehu died and was buried in Samaria, and his son Jehoahaz became king. Jehu had ruled Israel 28 years from Samaria. 2 Kings, chapter 11. As soon as Athaliah heard that her son King Ahaziah was dead, she decided to kill any relative who could possibly become king. She would have done that, but Jehosheba rescued Joash, son of Ahaziah, just as he was about to be murdered. Jehosheba, who was Jehoram's daughter and Ahaziah's half-sister, hid her nephew Joash and his personal servant in a bedroom in the Lord's temple, where he was safe from Athaliah. Joash hid in the temple with Jehosheba for 6 years, while Athaliah ruled as queen of Judah. Joash, son of Ahaziah, had hidden in the Lord's temple 6 years. Then in the 7th year, Jehoiada the priest sent for the commanders of the king's special bodyguards and the commanders of the palace guards. They met him at the temple, and he asked them to make a promise in the name of the Lord. Then he brought out Joash and said to them,
Here's what I want you to do. 3 of your guard units will be on duty on the Sabbath. I want one unit to guard the palace. Another unit will guard Sergate, and the 3rd unit will guard the palace gate and relieve the palace guards. The other 2 guard units are supposed to be off duty on the Sabbath, but I want both of them to stay here at the temple and protect King Joash. Make sure they follow him wherever he goes, and have them keep their swords ready to kill anyone who tries to get near him.
The commanders followed Jehoiada's orders. Each one called together his guards, those coming on duty and those going off duty. Jehoiada brought out the swords and shields that had belonged to King David and gave them to the commanders. Then they gave the weapons to their guards, who took their positions around the temple and the altar to protect Joash on every side. Jehoiada brought Joash outside, where he placed the crown on his head and gave him a copy of instructions for ruling the nation. Olive oil was poured on his head to show that he was now king, while the crowd clapped and shouted,
Long live the king!
Queen Athaliah heard the crowd and went to the temple. There she saw Joash standing by one of the columns, which was the usual place for the king. The singers and the trumpet players were standing next to him, and the people were celebrating and blowing trumpets. Athaliah tore her clothes in anger and shouted,
Traitors!
Right away, Jehoiada said to the army commanders,
Kill her, but don't do it anywhere near the Lord's temple. Take her out in front of the troops and kill anyone who is with her.
So the commanders dragged her to the gate where horses are led into the palace, and they killed her there. Jehoiada the priest asked King Joash and the people to promise that they would be faithful to each other and to the Lord. Then the crowd went to the temple built to honor Baal and tore it down. They smashed the altars and idols and killed Mattan, the priest of Baal, right in front of the altars. After Jehoiada had placed guards around the Lord's temple, he called together all the commanders, the king's special bodyguards, the palace guards, and the people. They led Joash from the temple through the guard's gate and into the palace. He took his place on the throne and became king of Judah. Everyone celebrated because Athaliah had been killed and Jerusalem was peaceful again. Joash was only 7 years old when this happened. 2 Kings, chapter 12. Joash became king of Judah in Jehu's seventh year as king of Israel, and he ruled 40 years from Jerusalem. His mother, Zibiah, was from the town of Beersheba. Jehoiada the priest taught Joash what was right, and so for the rest of his life Joash obeyed the Lord. But even Joash did not destroy the local shrines, and they were still used as places for offering sacrifices. One day, Joash said to the priests,
"Collect all the money that has been given to the Lord's temple, whether from taxes or gifts, and use it to repair the temple. You priests can contribute your own money too."
But the priests never started repairing the temple. So in the 23rd year of his rule, Joash called for Jehoiada and the other priests and said,
"Why aren't you using the money to repair the temple? Don't take any more money for yourselves. It is only to be used to pay for the repairs."
The priests agreed that they would not collect any more money or be in charge of the temple repairs. Jehoiada found a wooden box. He cut a hole in the top of it and set it on the right side of the altar where people went into the temple. Whenever someone gave money to the temple, the priests guarding the entrance would put it into this box. When the box was full of money, the king's secretary and the chief priest would count the money and put it in bags. Then they would give it to the men supervising the repairs to the temple. Some of the money was used to pay the builders, the woodworkers, the stonecutters, and the men who built the walls. And some was used to buy wood and stone, and to pay any other costs for repairing the temple. While the repairs were being made, the money that was given to the temple was not used to make silver bowls, lamp snuffers, small sprinkling bowls, trumpets, or anything gold or silver for the temple. It went only to pay for repairs. The men in charge were honest, so no one had to keep track of the money. The fines that had to be paid, along with the sacrifices to make things right and the sacrifices for sin, did not go to the temple. This money belonged only to the priests. About the same time, King Hazael of Syria attacked the town of Gath and captured it. Next, he decided to attack Jerusalem. So Joash collected everything he and his ancestors, Jehoshaphat, Jehoram, and Ahaziah had dedicated to the Lord, as well as the gold in the storage rooms in the temple and palace. He sent it all to Hazael as a gift, and when Hazael received it, he ordered his troops to leave Jerusalem. Everything else Joash did while he was king is written in the history of the kings of Judah. At the end of his rule, some of his officers rebelled against him. Jozabad, son of Shimeath, and Jehozabad, son of Shomer, murdered him in a building where the land was filled in on the east side of Jerusalem, near the road to Silla. Joash was buried beside his ancestors in Jerusalem, and his son Amaziah became king. 2 Kings Chapter 13. Jehoahaz, son of Jehu, became king of Israel in the 23rd year of Joash's rule in Judah. Jehoahaz ruled 17 years from Samaria and disobeyed the Lord by doing wrong. He never stopped following the example of Jeroboam, who had caused the Israelites to sin. The Lord was angry at the Israelites, so he let King Hazael of Syria and his son Ben-Hadad rule over them for a long time. Jehoahaz prayed to the Lord for help, and the Lord saw how terribly Hazael was treating the Israelites. He answered Jehoahaz by sending Israel a leader who rescued them from the Syrians, and the Israelites lived in peace as they had before. But Hazael had defeated Israel's army so badly that Jehoahaz had only 10 chariots, 50 cavalry troops, and 10,000 regular soldiers left in his army. The Israelites kept sinning and following the example of Jeroboam's family. They did not tear down the sacred poles that had been set up in Samaria for the worship of the goddess Asherah. Everything else Jehoahaz did while he was king, including his brave deeds, is written in the history of the kings of Israel. Jehoahaz died and was buried in Samaria, and his son Jehoash became king. Jehoash became king of Israel in the 37th year of Joash's rule in Judah, and he ruled 16 years from Samaria. He disobeyed the Lord by doing just like Jeroboam, who had caused the Israelites to sin. Everything else Jehoash did while he was king, including his war against King Amaziah of Judah, is written in the history of the kings of Israel. Jehoash died and was buried in Samaria beside the other Israelite kings. His son Jeroboam then became king. Sometime before the death of King Jehoash, Elisha the prophet was very sick and about to die. Jehoash went in and stood beside him crying. He said,
"Master, what will Israel's chariots and cavalry be able to do without you?"
"Grab a bow and some arrows,"
Elisha told him,
"and hold them in your hand."
Jehoash grabbed the bow and arrows and held them. Elisha placed his hand on the king's hand and said,
"Open the window facing east."
When it was open, Elisha shouted,
"Now shoot."
Jehoash shot an arrow, and Elisha said,
"That arrow is a sign that the Lord will help you completely defeat the Syrian army at Aphek."
Elisha said,
"Pick up the arrows and hit the ground with them."
Jehoash grabbed the arrows and hit the ground three times, then stopped. Elisha became angry at the king and exclaimed,
"If you had struck it five or six times, you would completely wipe out the Syrians. Now you will defeat them only three times."
Elisha died and was buried. Every year in the spring, Moab's leaders sent raiding parties into Israel. Once, while some Israelites were burying a man's body, they saw a group of Moabites. The Israelites quickly threw the body into Elisha's tomb and ran away. As soon as the man's body touched the bones of Elisha, the man came back to life and stood up. Israel was under the power of King Hazael of Syria during the entire rule of Jehoahaz. But the Lord was kind to the Israelites and showed them mercy because of his solemn agreement with their ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In fact, he has never turned his back on them or let them be completely destroyed. Hazael died, and his son Ben-Hadad then became king of Syria. King Jehoash of Israel attacked and defeated the Syrian army three times. He took back from Ben-Hadad all the towns Hazael had captured in battle from his father Jehoahaz.